All right, good morning, Uplift Church. And I hope the weather's getting warmer, and it's supposed to be 60 today, and we know that it's probably going to be 20 some other time during the week. It's the time of year that we never know what the weather's going to bring or what it's going to bring us, but that's kind of also a lot like life. We never really kind of know what it's going to bring from one day to the next. And it seems like you can have the most amazing experience and you're on cloud nine, and then it seemed like as fast as that came and you're just like, man, just walking on clouds, like everything is going so smoothly and it's great and you feel so close to God, you know, with your family and everybody's in harmony, and like then something can happen. It just seems like, oh man, I didn't see that coming. And this is where we struggle at. Because we're trying to find this place where we had this peace and we had this joy in our life. But a lot of that joy is often misplaced because of our thoughts or our ideas of where that actually comes from. And so last week we kind of nailed this down that, you know, this obtaining joy, like these joys, it's not about how far we get in life and about how much money we can obtain or how much riches or things or even people that we are over. But it's actually when we serve. And that was what Jesus said, that we should be serving. And I hope that you found an opportunity to serve this past week, serve someone, particularly starting at home, that, you know, serving your wife, serving your husband, serving your kids, starting at home and serving them. And it could be something as so simple as just, well, last week we were talking about vacuuming the blinds, and maybe you actually went home and vacuumed your blinds. And if that doesn't mean anything to you, then I encourage you to go back and watch last week's message. You can do that on our website. But serving. And our culture has created this, almost this idea that for you to have joy, you to have true joy, it's about obtaining so much status or obtaining so many things. But then last week we said, okay, Jesus, he kind of went against that and said, no, it's about serving. And I think that we're okay with that. We're okay with serving. We're okay with serving others as long as it's on our terms. How many times have you said, you know, I will help them, you know, but I know that they wouldn't do the same for me? Or somebody will help us and you'll be like, thank you so much. Or they're thanking you. And you're like, well, I know that you would do the same for me. But see, we're not helping others so that we can get something in return. We do it just because that's what we've been commanded to do, is to serve others, to love others. And I know that sometimes it's hard. And just like we talked about last week, it's going to be a never-ending battle. Because you're going to go back and forth between serving others and serving yourself. It's going to be a constant battle. And this battle is going to continue to go on. And of all the things that Jesus ever did, of all the things that he ever taught, serving is probably the most important part. And we said last week that never are we more like God than whenever we choose to serve. And sometimes it's a challenge, because sometimes you don't want to. You don't feel like it. You would rather not. And sometimes it can be hard. Others, it's hard for us to kind of sympathize with people. Like, we don't know, like, I'm not going to help them. Or no, we're not going to. They can do it. They can handle it themselves. But Jesus set an example for us that we would serve regardless. See, at the close of the end of Jesus' walk, he spent his last 3 years pouring himself into these 12 men. Pouring himself. So they went on all these different adventures together. They were present during many of these miracles that Jesus performed. They ate together. They slept in the same rooms. They traveled on boats together. And of all this, it came down to these last few days of Jesus' life. And what they were getting ready to celebrate is what's known as the Passover. Now, the Passover was this feast. It was this celebration that they celebrated every year. It was a very important celebration. Much more than Christmas. Much more than what we had put on birthdays. This celebration was to remind them and to honor what God did for them. So if you look all the way back in Exodus, the Israelites, they were slaves in the country, Egypt. They were there for 400 years. Slaves, beaten, overworked, extremely underpaid, taken advantage of, verbally and physically. And along with these, they cried out to God to save them. So this is where God sent Moses. And he called Moses out of the burning bush. Moses, I'm sending you to go lead my people out of Egypt. Moses went. And here we see these plagues of Egypt. The last one being the death of the firstborn. And they had this very specific custom they had to do. They were to take this goat or lamb, they were to take this sacrifice, and they were going to sacrifice it. And they were supposed to eat this meal in a very certain way, with very specific bread, even a very specific way to even to prepare the meat. They had to take the blood from that sacrifice. They had to catch it in a bucket. They had to catch it. And with that, they would take some of that blood, and they had to go to their front door. And they had to put some on the top post and the side post. That night, God would send out His death angel to go out through the land. And any house that did not have that blood on those parts, top and the two sides, the death angel would enter in and would take the life of the firstborn. Every house that had that blood, the death angel passed over. It passed over. Thus gives us the Passover. After they fled out of Egypt, after the Pharaoh let them go, this is one of the things that God established for them to practice every year, to remember the Passover. And so you come to this close to the very end of Jesus' life, and they're getting ready to celebrate the Passover. He sends some disciples to go prepare the room. And I'm not sure exactly how it looked. You've seen some paintings by some very famous painters of about like a depiction of what that Last Supper may have looked like. But we know that they didn't have quite electricity like we have now. Super Dave, could you just cut a couple of these lights out right here? Not all of them, just a few of these lights out. And when they probably had some sort of candles or some sort of lamps. And it was some sort of dimmer setting. The table was prepared. And they shared in this Passover meal together. Now, I want to ask you a question. How many disciples did Jesus have? How many did He have? How many? Somebody tell me. 12 disciples. So there's a place sitting for all 12 plus Jesus. Of these 12, we know that one of them has a very sad fate, but yet they were all present. So this is where our lesson picks up today. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to John chapter 13 as we dive into this last feast, this last meal that Jesus shared. And I'm just going to leave the lights kind of dim like this. Just it was kind of dim that night. And just want to kind of just give you an idea about what took place that night. John chapter 13. It starts here in verse 1. It says, before the Passover festival, Jesus knew that His hour had come to depart from this world to the Father. Having loved His own who were in the world, He loved them to the end. Now, I love this verse because the Passover there, it's time. Jesus is getting ready to go to the cross. And with this, they're all going to celebrate this Passover, Jesus very intimately with His 12 disciples. And with this, they're all coming together, but it says that He loved His own who were in the world. Jesus loved these men. He loved them. And I like what it said there, that He loved them to the end. All of these, Now, again, when we think of these disciples, we immediately, our minds and our thoughts and our attention goes to Peter, James, and John. That's what you always see very intimately. But there was also Andrew. There was also James. There was also Judas. And they're all present and accounted for. And he loved them to the end. I want you to understand that he loved them all. Now, this was Jesus, the same Jesus that walked on water, who turned water into wine, that healed many blind people where they could see. There was this one time that he was in a house and these men opened up the roof, lowered down their friend who was crippled, and Jesus healed him. And he walked home. The last miracle we see here that kind of set his death into motion is that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. He had been in the grave 4 days. 4 days. And yet they rolled that stone away. They opened up that tomb. And he called Lazarus to come forth. And Lazarus came walking out. He told everybody else, hey guys, cut your grave clothes off. And it says there that these people, these religious people, from that point on, they sought for a way to kill Jesus. Jesus knew the time was coming. And yet, here they are, celebrating this very important meal, this very important celebration. So they ate together. Now we'll pick back up at verse 4. So they ate together. So in verse 4, so he got up from supper, laid aside his robe, took a towel and tied it around himself. Next, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet and to dry them with the towel tied around him. Jesus, who could heal the blind, who could look at a demon-possessed man and have those demons cast into pigs. This is Jesus that with his words could call the dead to come forth. And what he does is after they share this meal together, he dresses himself for service. He dresses himself to serve these 12 men. By taking on the lowest of services. For then, your feet was very nasty. This is also the reason why I don't wear flip-flops. I go to the beach, I'm that guy that wears shoes. I'm not a fan. And you may do it, and my kids love sandals and flip-flops and all that. I'm not a fan. It's very weird wearing your tennis shoes out, but I know you can make fun of that too. But the reason why their feet were so nasty is because of these open sandals for them traveling on these dirt roads. Could you imagine how nasty they would get? And so this lowest servant of the house would customary to wash the feet of the guest. And this is what Jesus did. The same Jesus that took a small boy's lunch and fed 5,000 people with it. More than 5,000, counting women and children. This was the same Jesus that spit in mud and put it on a man's eyes and he could see. He had all this power, all this authority, and yet he dressed himself for service and washed the disciples' feet. So then he came to Peter. Look at verse 6. So he came to Simon Peter, who asked him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus answered him, what I'm doing you don't understand, but afterward you will know. And verse 8, he says, you will never wash my feet, ever. See the exclamation point? He wasn't just saying, no, Lord, you're not going to wash my feet. I mean, this is Peter. Hot-headed, arrogant Peter. He says, no, you will never wash my feet, ever, with the exclamation point. But Jesus said, if I don't wash you, you have no part of me. And what Jesus is trying to teach his disciples is that all this greatness, all this power, all this authority means nothing if we are not serving others. Serving others. This basically goes against our culture right now. It goes against our society to talk about, oh, it's all about you and what you can obtain and what you want. You get a job at the company, it's about you moving up. It's about you going out in life and obtaining more stuff and obtaining more stuff and obtaining more stuff. But that's all that it is more stuff. More stuff. So Jesus said, if I don't wash you, you have no part with me. What in the world is Jesus trying to teach these disciples? He's trying to show them by example that it's about how we serve others. Serving others. Yes, how we treat one another. How well we love God and love people. And church, we can say it with our words all we want to. But the proof is in what we do. How would you rather someone show you that they love you? By telling you or by showing you? I mean, I like to be told. I do. I really like to be told. But man, when I can see it, man, it just makes it so much more real. I can feel that love. Man, and then it grows. And it just grows. But see, so many times we put stipulations on it. Oh, I'll love them and I'll show them once they do this, and this. So then Peter goes on, and verse 9, he agrees. He said, okay. So Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands, my head. I think this is very strange. I would never ask another man, especially Jesus, to wash my head. It's just very weird. But he does. But then Jesus comes back with him, and he says, one who has bathed, Jesus told him, doesn't need to wash anything except his feet. But he is completely clean. He said, you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him. This is why he said, you are not all clean. Church, I want you to understand this. All right? All sitting around. All these men. We got Peter, James, John, Andrew, Matthew. All these around. One of these was Judas. I want you to understand about this service. That Jesus got down. He dressed himself for service and he washed the very feet of the one who would betray him. Now let that sink in for a moment. He washed the feet of the one who was going to turn him into the authorities. He even used words like, I love them all to the end. Church, this is a great example that Jesus' love has no end. He loves you just the way you are. That you can't make yourself better. You can't make yourself lovable. He just wants you. He's telling Peter here, no, you're clean. Your feet's nasty, but you're clean. But not all of you. There's one among you. There's one among you who's not. Verse 12. When Jesus had washed their feet, he put on his robe. And then he reclined again and he said to them, do you know what I've done for you? I love this. Do you know? And he's really trying to emphasize this to the disciples. See, I think it kind of odd that when it comes down to the very end, this is the last little bit of freedom that Jesus has. The very last few hours of his freedom, instead of him doing something grand, they're sharing a meal together. And his very last act was washing some dirty feet. He was getting ready to go to the cross, church. And this was the last thing that he did was serving others, one of them being Judas, who would betray him. Now, he asked, "Do you understand? Do you know what I've done for you?" And as I've been studying this and reading this, I'm thinking, man, what would it have been like to be one of the disciples? Church, I'm not so sure that I would have understood. This is the same man that he just caught his dead friend out of the grave. This is the same man that we were scared to death on a boat thinking we were going to die, and he just comes up and he goes, "Peace be still." And the calmness comes over the waters. And yet he dressed himself for service. The reason why is because this was the most important lesson. See, all these other miracles, all this was just proving that he was who he said he was. And who did Jesus say he was? The Son of God. Often referred to himself as the Son of Man. So Jesus, he wasn't glorified in all the miracles. He was trying to point everybody to God. Here is the nuts and bolts of ministry and life that he's trying to tell others, tell us to serve others. And he dressed himself for ministry, he dressed himself for service, and he got down and he washed some dirty feet. Even Judas. And he goes on to explain to make sure they understand this. And he said, verse 13, he said, "You call me teacher and Lord. This is well said, for I am. I am the teacher and the Lord. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you should also do just as I have done for you." Wow. Jesus said, "Yes, I am the Lord, I am the Master, and yet I dressed myself for service and got down on my hands, my knees, and washed your feet." And he says, "I'm setting the example for you to follow." I love what he said here. "You also ought to wash one another's feet." Jesus set the example. See, the greatness wasn't in the miracles. It was in the service. It was in this service. This simple act. We all want to do something great for God and do something great and be just really impactful. But what Jesus is drawing their attention to is the simple acts of service. Can you think of a simple act of service that maybe that you've done recently, or maybe that you could have done but you didn't? It could be as simple as making your kid a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. When you want to make your kid today, you make them a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. There's just something about it. It's quite delicious. And I still like it. Man, if you really want to go over the top, man, you make them a grilled cheese and put brown sugar on it. We're talking the Lord's goodness now. It's good stuff. This simple act of service. See how simple this is? We had some ladies that volunteered this morning, and they brought some delicious goodies out here. And there's sausage balls, and I don't know what this one thing is, but it looks like like a cheese Danish, but it's really, really good. You can get some when you leave. There's some more coffee out there. It's Black Rifle. It's good stuff. Simple acts of service. And church, I just want you to understand this, that when we come to this acts of service, it's not that we're doing something great or that we're doing something grand. It's that we're doing this one to another, that we treat each other this way. Now, he also said here about washing each other's feet. This does not mean that, you know, you welcome somebody into, you know, your home, you're all right, take off your socks and shoes, and I'm going to wash your feet. No. You ain't. It wasn't about the feet washing. It was about the service. It was about him dressing himself for ministry, dressing himself to serve, and then for them to follow suit. To treat each other this very same way, to serve one another. It's not about how great your name is. It's not how great your career is. It's not about how much money you die with or how much you can accumulate. For none of that stuff is probably going to be ever said over you when you leave this world. Man, I've never had anybody send over a casket and say, man, they drove a really nice car. Did you know the square footage of their house? It was such and such. Nobody cares. But they do care how you treat others. Do you see what we're saying here? We can put so much focus and attention where Jesus is trying to redirect it to what really matters. How we treat one another. How we serve one another. And he confirms it. Look at verse 16. He says, I assure you, a slave is not greater than his master. A messenger is not greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Church, this is where the blessing is at. You want to be blessed? Then serve someone else. Serve your spouse. Serve your kids. Serve the people you work with. You know, man, how can I serve the people that I work with? Church, it could be as simple as whenever the coffee pot's empty, you making another pot. It may be that when the Culligan water at your office place is empty, that you be the one who lugs it up there and changes it. A simple act of service. This is how we're supposed to treat one another. By this example. And this is the very last act of what Jesus is doing. And then he confirms it. David Smith had asked some people to come up here, and if y'all would, I want to ask you if you would to go ahead and join us up here on the stage. You're going to see some people coming up. I just want you to come up and go ahead and have your seat. It doesn't matter which seat you pick, just grab one. Jesus was in that upper room, this Passover feast, and there with him there were 12 disciples. And he comes down to a conclusion. So he's got them gathered around. And he comes down to a conclusion. Look at this verse in verse 18. He says, I'm not speaking about all of you. I know those I have chosen, but the scripture must be fulfilled. The one who eats my bread has raised his heel against me. And church, he's speaking about Judas. And they're sharing this meal, this intimacy. He's got down on his hands and feet, and he's washed their feet. They've shared bread together. And if I know somebody's got something against me, I sure ain't going to eat with them. But Jesus did. And he washed their feet. We want to do stuff like egg their car. And Jesus is, no, we're going to get down. We're going to dress ourselves for ministry. We're going to dress ourselves for service and wash their feet. And then he serves them, and they eat together. And as they do this, and as they're eating together, he comes to this conclusion that his time is coming to an end. What he does is that he calls Judas out, and he tells him, he says, listen, now what you've done, do it quickly. He calls Judas out. But they're doing this stuff together. These 12 here represent the 12 disciples there that night. But I want you to understand that they also represent you. You. You and your presence there that night. When Jesus established a new covenant, when Jesus established something new, no longer would they celebrate the Passover, and we don't celebrate the Passover. Instead, what we do is we celebrate and practice the Lord's Supper, or communion, in which we have juice and crackers that we share amongst ourselves. But I want to do something different today in which you got to witness this. So I've asked these 12 to join us up here. Jesus came down to these very last nuts and bolts of all this life and all this ministry, and it came down to this. Their view of Jesus and what they were going to do with it. And so what they're going to do here on the stage with me, and we're going to lead this together, but we're going to partake of this Lord's Supper, but I want you to see this from a viewpoint. And as you see this, I want you to, if you can picture yourself there that night, Jesus dressed himself for ministry, had washed their feet, and began teaching them about how he was getting ready to be betrayed, setting things into motion was Judas. And then he comes down to this last part. He's been teaching them about his death that's coming. And it says this, and this is in Luke. This is not on the screen. I just want you to listen. Okay, this is in Luke chapter 22. And he said, when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, with desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. And again, he's talking about how he's going to the cross. He'd already washed their feet. And now he's doing some very intimate teaching with them. And he says, for I say unto you, I will not eat any more until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And with this, he shared in what we have laid out here, which is just there they used wine. We use Welch's grape juice. And a small bread. And when he gave this to them, and he said, I want you to take this and divide it among yourselves, because they didn't have the little small wafers that we've got now. They would have like a loaf of bread, and so they would pass it around, and each one would take some. This is something new that I'm giving to you. And so what he did is that he took the bread. So if y'all would go ahead and take your bread. He took this bread. And it says that he gave thanks. Even though that his life was coming to the very end, he took time to give thanks unto God. So he says he took the bread and he gave thanks. And I'm not sure how big or elaborate this was. And it may just been one of those small flower prayers. God, may you bless this and the coming of your kingdom and what it represents. So he took the bread and he gave thanks, and it said, and then he broke it, and then he gave it to them, and he said, this is my body, which is given for you. And then he says this do in remembrance of me. And then they ate it. Now go ahead. This do in remembrance of me. Now, what do we remember? What does this allow us to remember? All the miracles? Just the miracles? Because he wants us to remember this last act, that he served others, and that particularly that his body was now the Passover lamb. This is why we don't celebrate this Passover feast anymore, because now we do communion, we do the Lord's Supper, just as in this. Because of what the heart of it is what it took next. And he said, so, I'm going to grab mine. So then likewise, after they'd done this, he took the cup after supper, and he said, this cup is the New Testament. So he's given a new covenant, this New Testament, in my blood, which is shed for you. And then they shared it. Jesus shared this with these 12 disciples. After they got done, what they did that night is that they began to sing. They sang hymns. I'm not going to have these guys to sing for you. But what I want you to put yourself into place is that you are here. In this very last act of what Jesus shared was to serve one another. Now, I didn't recruit these guys. David Smith did. But this was an act of serving. They served in this example to come here. We had two ladies that shared an act of serving this morning, and they brought some treats that's out here this morning. We got some people serving in kids' church, our preteens in our kids' church, and they're doing an act of serving. We have some guys in the parking lot and some people at the door greeting people, signing kids in, an act of service. We've got Super Dave, who's running the sound booth by himself. That's an act of service. We got Chris on the camera, who's doing an act of service. We got Wendy, who's running our online campus. That's an act of service. There's a whole lot of planning and other things behind the scenes. We've got a lady who, she's adamant that nobody vacuums these rugs unless she does it. It's an act of service. We got another lady, she likes the broom and the dustpan. She comes into church early so she can sweep. We got some kids who clean up the bathrooms every Sunday as an act of service. In church, I'm not talking about just in church. And saying about how we treat one another. Me and Fish were sitting in chairs this morning, and these kids came up and said, how many more chairs do you need? An act of service. An act of service. I want you to understand, I believe that it should start at home. But it should go into your everyday part of your life. Your act of service. Who are you serving? Who in your life is it that maybe you need to dress yourself for service and to serve? We have been called out. Thank you guys for your help. You can return to your seats. I don't know. I'm not sure how it would have been that night. I don't know how Jesus had the courage to share that meal the way in which he did. But when he said, this do in remembrance of me, I believe he was talking about more than just the communion, and that he died and that he rose again for us. But remember what he did as his last very act. Church, he served. And he said, this is where the blessings come from. It's how we serve one another. I don't know where you're at right now in your relationship with God or your relationship with people. But right now, we have been called out to serve. To serve. The question is how is the condition of your heart so that you may serve others? How is the condition of your heart that you may be of service unto others? We want to give you an opportunity because we've already got one who's volunteered for next week. They're going to bring us some nice treats. It's going to go along with some coffee, and we're going to have that next week as well. And maybe that's something that you want to do. You want to do an act of service. You're not, but I can't bake. That's okay. Krispy Kreme has Hot Now Donuts every Sunday. An act of service. Maybe there's someone in your life that needs your act of service, that you may be able to serve them. Maybe you have a Judas in your life. Maybe you have someone that's just a thorn in your flesh, and still yet Jesus still dressed himself for service and washed his feet. Man, if I knew that somebody was getting ready to betray me, I could think of a lot of things that I could do, but washing their feet wouldn't be one of them. But yet this is the example. And Jesus said, this do in remembrance of me. Do this Last Supper. Do this communion in remembrance of me. Don't just remember all the miracles, but this new covenant in this last act of service. In this last command that he gave to his disciples was serve one another. So let's back up again. How's the condition of your heart? Are you ready to serve? Are you ready to serve? No stipulations. Just are you ready to serve? Maybe there's someone in your life that you know that you need to serve. Maybe that does need to start at home. Or maybe you need to go a little bit step beyond that. Maybe it's something here with church. Maybe it's something with your work. Or maybe it's something in your community or your neighborhood where, in which you live. Maybe it could be as simple as baking some cookies and taking it to your neighbor. Just an act of service. Would you pray with me right now? Father, we thank you for your word, for what it means to us. And God, I just pray that right now through the presence and power of your Holy Spirit, God, that you would speak. right now. We need you, Father. We've been given a great challenge, a great example. Sometimes, Father, I feel overwhelmed. I feel like that I'm undeserving, I'm unworthy. Sometimes, God, there's people in my life that I need to serve, and I don't want to. Sometimes when I even think about serving, I just get filled up with anxiety and overwhelmed. This is why, Father, right now, we're going to take a moment to pray for ourselves. If you're here this morning, God is moving in your life and He's working in your life. You just feel like that there's a stirring of God. Man, but you feel that anxiety, you feel like, man, something's in your way. Something's just keeping you from serving in this capacity, whether it be here at church or in your home or in your office. Right now is the opportunity for you to clear the air between you and God. Whatever's in your way of serving others. Right now, what do you need? Maybe this morning, what your immediate need is, maybe your burden this morning. Now, I'm going to encourage you to come down. Last week we did this, and we're going to do the same thing this morning. If you're burdened this morning, you need somebody to pray over you. You don't have to share anything. You have to tell us what's going on. But we would love to have the opportunity just to lay our hands on you and just to pray for you. If that's you this morning, if you've got this burden, you need to lay it down at Jesus' feet. May we pray for you? I'm going to ask you right now, nobody's looking around. I'm just asking if you would just to come to this altar and we'll pray for you. If that's you this morning, would you come? Would you come? Nobody's looking around. I'm just asking if you would come. And church, I'm going to tell you the same thing that this pastor told me the night when I surrendered my life to Christ. If you feel that something's not right, you feel that your heartbeat's racing and you just feel like that God's speaking, but you don't really know what to do. That's not me. That's not the music. That's not even the message, but that's my Heavenly Father drawing you to Him. Now, will you respond? Will you come? Church, this morning, if you're burdened, you need someone to pray for you, we would love to have that opportunity. I'm asking if you would to come. Right now. Father, you know exactly what we need. God, you know when we need. Forgive us of our many faults and failures and help us, God, to walk close to you. This morning, Father, we've been called out to serve one another. And right now, Father, we uplift those that we need to serve. And I encourage you right now, just pray for those. Call their names out to God right now, those in your life who you know you need to serve. Let's start with the easy ones. Let's start with the easy ones in your life right now that you need to serve. Whether it be a spouse or a friend, someone that right now that you need to serve. Right now, would you just uplift those people right now to the Lord in prayer? Who you need to serve. Just lift them up to the Lord right now. Whoever that may be. Lord, help me as I serve so-and-so. That I put myself aside to serve. Some of you maybe got somebody a little bit difficult in your life that you know that you should be serving, that you, Lord's been laying something on your heart, and maybe you've just neglected to do that. And this morning you need to pray for that difficult one. Would you uplift him to the Lord right now? This is where our joy comes from. This is where our blessings come from. So would you pray? Would you pray for that one this morning right now? It may be difficult. Would you pray for them? Father, you hear these names coming up to you. Some are easy to serve and others are not. But God, we just give them over to you. And we just ask, Father, right now, you just lead us and guide us, God, that we may give you not only our very best, but God, that you would help us as we try to serve others. Some, Father, are easy to serve. I think others are more like Judas and a little bit more difficult. It's challenging. Oh, Father, may you lead us and guide us. God, that our words and our actions through service, God, would show people how great you are. That if you can change us, God, you can change anybody. And right now, Father, we just uplift these names to you. People in our life that need your love. And maybe it's going to be through our act of service in which they see it. Father, you're so great. And you're not done with us yet. So may you continue to move and work, Father, in our lives in such a way that people see you through us. Thank you, Father, for being so good. As you continue to pray, there may be something going on in your life right now. You just love to have somebody to pray for you. May I have that opportunity? If you got something going on in your life and you just need somebody to pray for you, may I just pray for you? Just raise your hand up and say, hey, would you just pray for me? There's hands going up everywhere. Anybody else say, hey, would you just pray for me? God, you see these hands? God, they represent real people with real burdens, things weighing on them. Oh, Father, we just uplift them to you and pray, God, that you would intervene. God, that you would move and work in such a way, God, that they'd be able to make the right decisions, to love on those that need to be loved on. God, that they might be disciplined enough to be able to see you through for whatever it is you've laid upon their heart. God, I pray for every family and every marriage here. Satan seeks to destroy it, but you seek to restore it. God, may your will be done. Father, we have a lot of people watching online today because there's sickness everywhere around us. God, would you touch those that are sick? And may you be able to speak, Father, through this camera right to their homes, that they know that they're loved and that we've been called to serve. God, you've shared a few things on us, but help us, God, that we may be able to seek an opportunity, that we may be able to serve others. Because you're not done with us yet. There's still work to be done. So help us, God, this week. That as we go to work, as we go get gas, and as we go to the grocery stores, as we go out to eat, that people will be able to see you through us and to be in our actions in a way in which we choose to serve others. It could be as simple as a smile and a thank you, or it could be as simple as baking some cookies. Help us, Father, now. As we leave here from the day, and we go serve, all in the name of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Would you take a moment with God some praise?